Hello and welcome to Tourism Northern Ireland's TED programme series of digital webinars. I'm Michelle Connolly from Profile Tree, and today we're going to be thinking about video production and video editing. Now, video as a medium in the tourism and travel industry is an amazing way to really showcase that experience that potential visitors or travellers are going to get. It can really help you connect on an emotional sense and give people a really great insight into the service you offer, the experience that they're going to get, the place that they're going to stay, and it really, really showcases everything in a completely different light than other forms of content out there. However, in the current situation, video has become even more important. If you think about it, businesses who would traditionally never use video or were afraid of it have been forced into a situation where they're using it for Zoom, they're using it for communication, and we're probably spending 2 to 3 hours on videos every day. So it really has even accelerated the importance of creating video content even more. So without further ado, let's get started. So just a quick overview of what we will cover today and the format of the presentation. So basically what we will do is I will take you through the presentation, and there will also be a chat feature available. So do feel free to drop in questions to chat throughout the presentation, but there will also be a time for questions and answers at the end. This video is pre-recorded, so do feel free to go back and look at different points in it. There's going to be quite a lot within it, so it might be a good idea to revisit different points as you maybe miss them as you go through. But as I say, do feel free to drop questions in the chat and I will be available to answer those throughout the video and during the Q&A session at the end. So let's have a think about what we're going to cover. So we're going to think about why video is so important. We're going to think about the different types of videos and how you can make that variety within your business and to really suit different audiences. We're going to think about planning for video, and this is probably one of the most important steps in video production. We're going to look at filming tips, and we're also going to look at simple editing tips. So by the end of this, you should really be well prepared to go out and start shooting your first simple video. So I'll be looking forward to seeing all of those later on as well. So let's have a think about, first of all, why video is becoming so, so important. So consumers nowadays love video content because it's entertaining, it's engaging, and it's easy to digest. And if you think about travel and tourism and the beautiful scenery and the experiences that people can have, travel is an amazing niche to be in order to create amazing video content. The versatility of it makes it easy to share across multiple platforms, and it means that you can expand your audience and really, really build that brand awareness for what you do very, very quickly and very easily. If we look at mobile alone, YouTube in itself reaches more 18 to 49 year olds than any broadcast or cable TV network in the world. And it's absolutely amazing to think that people are accessing this information via the likes of YouTube now. They're moving away from those more traditional senses of being able to access content. So we have to really bear that in mind when we are actually creating content for our businesses. YouTube is actually the second biggest search engine in the world, visited after Google and Facebook. So it's actually the third most visited site after Google and Facebook. So if you can imagine people searching for your service, for your business, for your experience, where are they going to? They're going to Google first and then they're going to YouTube. So if you do not have the video content on there to support it, they're not able to find you. So just, you know, bear that in mind when you're thinking about your content production and what you're actually putting out there to the market. So the opportunities in travel are massive. If you have a look, I've just taken a screenshot from YouTube, and this is a search I carried out. So if you can imagine, I just typed into the search bar at the top, Travel Northern Ireland, and you can see the results. In fact, you can go away after this or during this and search it yourself. But what amazes me is what comes up is basically other content from people who are travel bloggers, people from other countries. There are very few Belfast or Northern Ireland businesses there that are actually promoting themselves in YouTube. It is the big travel bloggers. It is, as I say, other companies, people who visited rather than people who are trying to promote their business. So the opportunities are there for the taking in terms of YouTube and video marketing. There are so many opportunities in the travel and tourism industry to be part of that search and to be coming up in those search results. The reason we're getting the travel bloggers and everything, yes, they have a great following, but there's so little content that's being produced by businesses in Northern Ireland around the travel industry. And really, we need to be starting to get up and out there and really promoting ourselves. So we're going to look at different types of content. We're going to look at the different types of video content that you might create, different styles, different brands. What I want you to do is to think through, as we're talking through these different types of content, which lends itself best to your business? Which can you see yourself creating? And what will showcase what you do in the best light? So let's have a look at the different types of content that there are out there. So the first type of video content we're going to look at is face to camera. Now, this is probably the most well-known type of video content. It's basically you talking straight to camera. It's really, really good if you're, say, for example, making a new announcement about a new service that you're offering, talking about your business or the process or the experience. But it's usually an informational piece rather than a creative piece. And it's a great way to build that personal brand, build brand awareness, and really give people information about your business. It's probably one of the easiest ways to create video content, but it would be important to consider what you want to say on there and be quite succinct, concise, and to the point. So let's have a look at the next type. Tips and advice or how-to videos. These are amazing, especially in the hospitality industry where you've got access to recipes, food, food and drink, cocktails. And I'm just going to play you a little sample of a how-to video. And again, these are great for brand awareness. They're great for audience sharing. They're great to just really showcase the experience and the atmosphere of what people are going to get when they come to you. But also, video is a really, really good way of educating people. And we would always say when we're creating video content that we educate first, entertain first, and sell secondly, because people want that education piece. They want to be entertained. They want to learn new things. They don't always want to be just sold at. And this is a really nice way of subtly selling your services, subtly selling your experience without being very salesy and very aggressive or direct. So I'm just going to play you a little bit of this Cinderella Mocktail how-to. It's a video, it has over 50,000 views on YouTube, and it's just amazing to see how a simple how-to video can really, really lead into such engagement and really, as I say, build an audience around it.
Hello, Steve the barman from the Lakeside Bar and Grill here at the Killeheaven Hotel. For the drivers out there that still want to have the cocktail effect, today we're doing a mocktail known as the Cinderella. So the first thing you'll do is sugar a martini glass. Then, in our cocktail shaker full of ice, we will be adding 25 orange juice, pineapple, and 25 grenadine. As always, shake until ice cold and pour. And for the sparkling effect, we simply top off our mocktail with soda water.
So as you can see, really quite simple to set up, really quite simple to fill them, but again, really gives people that insight into what they can experience and really, really shareable, even more important. So the next thing we're going to look at is the experience. video. And again, it's giving people a really nice insight into what you do and how you do it and what they're going to experience and really the buzz and the excitement and everything else that goes with that experience. And again, I'm going to just show you a very, very short little clip around how you can do that. It's a really, really good way of, again, I suppose, getting people to share your content and to promote audience engagement and build people's awareness of what they'll be getting when they come to visit you.
Okay, so welcome to Belfast Cookery School. I'm Ian, your chef for this evening, assisted by Aaron and Amelia. This is a bit different than a normal class, so there's no set starter, main course and dessert. Okay, it's a one-pot wonder class, which is accompanied by a beautiful broccoli dish or fresh bread, which I have made a thing for here, okay?
As you can see, just another really great way of just giving people an insight into what you do. To me, this video sells that experience well, way, way more than actually creating a video that says, come and buy this experience, this is what you're going to do. Show people rather than tell them is what we really would say with video content. Another great way of creating content, and this is a fantastic way of creating content because you don't even have to create it yourself, is to use user-generated content. And what I mean by that is that if you've had visitors come and that are creating content, if you have had bloggers or influencers or anything like that, and people have created videos of your experience or of your hotel or of your B&B or of your restaurant, actually share that content. Ask them if you can have access to that content. Embed that content into your website, and it's another great way of showcasing what you do. And the beauty of this style of content is that because it's user generated, people will trust it more and people will engage with it more as well, because as I say, they are putting themselves in those people's shoes and they can really empathize with them as a visitor. So it is a really, really good way to showcase your business in a completely different light to showcasing it yourself. So I would say do feel free to reach out to people that you think have done a really good job when they visited your experience or your hotel or wherever else, or taken part in a tour, and actually ask them, is it okay to embed their stuff into your website or to share their stuff out to really showcase your experience. Another great way of showcasing your business video is an interview style video. And again, these are great because it kind of takes the pressure off that very face to camera, that very structured type of video. And it allows you to really, again, showcase what you do, showcase your staff, showcase the experience that people are going to get. And I know we talk about the new brand with Tourism Northern Ireland and, you know, Embrace the Giants Fair, but that's really what we are about in Northern Ireland. And things like an interview can really help showcase that giant spirit in terms of the passion and the excitement that people have for what they do in the tourism sector. So a simple interview. So this is an interview with a chef here. So you might interview a chef in your business. You might interview one of your tour guides. And again, just giving people an insight into the experience they're going to get, the background and the history and the story around it, because people love that. And really that is part of the travel experience, is the story and the background and the history and the culture and all those things coming together. And video was a really good way of showcasing that. So we're also going to look at different types of video, which is a vlog. And again, this is a really nice style of video. This is what we would call quite a raw style of video. So it doesn't have to be very polished and beautiful and very high-end production Hollywood value. This is literally cataloguing a journey as part of your experience. So almost that start to end, looking at that visitor journey from where they started out and the experience that they had and that kind of summing up around it. So it's a really, really nice way. It's a very, as I say, raw type of video style, and it's very face to camera, but chatting away. And you'll see lots of travel bloggers and vloggers doing it really well on YouTube, and I would check those out. So it might be that you do invite somebody, like a micro influencer or a blogger, to come and do a vlog of your experience and what you've got to offer. And again, it almost ties in really nicely with that user generated content, and it really gives people a different aspect or a different insight into what you have to offer. Now, I'm going to talk about voiceover as well. And the reason I'm going to talk about voiceover is it's a really good way of showcasing scenery. It's also a really good video style for people that maybe aren't 100% comfortable with video just yet. But I think with the pandemic and COVID-19, we're getting a wee bit more comfortable with video, which is great. But it is just a nice way sometimes of showcasing nice scenery with a nice informational piece with voiceover. And as long as that voiceover is really well planned, a voiceover video with scenery can be very, very, very effective and very, very impactful. So do consider it as another style of medium for video content. The next thing we're going to look at is storytelling. And because of course people love a story, and you know, it is part of our culture in Northern Ireland, is the storytelling and the excitement of that. And I'm just going to show you a little bit of an excerpt from a Marriott video about storytelling. Obviously, this is very high commercial value, probably cost a lot of money to make. But it's the essence of the story that I want you to think about, the experience that people are having. So let me just play this and we can, as I say, really think about that storytelling element.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes.
Security is at a maximum, and authorities are on high alert as the Purple Panther thieves may be in LA.
And something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind.
And I'm going to pause it there because I will put all the links to these videos in the description for you to go and watch afterwards. But as I say, even though they've probably spent an absolute fortune creating the video, it's the storytelling aspect that I want you to really think about. They go through the characters and they really think about their audience and how different people will enjoy their hotel experience. And that's what you need to be doing when you're creating your video content, is to think about that, is to think about your different audiences and what's going to appeal to them. What part of your experience can you showcase to them that's going to really make them think, yes, that is the place I want to go and visit, because they have got everything at their fingertips and they can see it visually through video. So moving on, and these are all the different types of videos types that you might consider. And as I say, each one has its own different merit, but you might think about making different ones for different reasons, as we discussed throughout the presentation. So we're going to think about creating a content plan. Now, back to what I said at the very beginning, creating a content plan for video is probably the most important part of video production. What people generally tend to do is they jump into creating a video because everybody else is creating video and they feel like, I need a video for my business, and they don't maybe really think through why they're creating it, how they're going to create it, and what they want people to do with it afterwards. So it is really, really important to think about this content plan and what you really want to get out of creating a video, because, you know, I'm very well aware that creating video takes longer than probably writing a blog. takes longer than writing a social media post, so you want to get it right. So task one is generating ideas. So what I would say is to, if you have a few other staff members in your business, or if you've got family members, is to sit down and really generate ideas of what you could do to really showcase your business and be as creative as you like out there. So, I mean, there's so many different sectors within the tourism sector. You've got tour guiding, you've got restaurants, you've got hospitality, you've got B&Bs, you've got hotels, and everybody offers something really unique and something really different. And that's what you really need to be thinking about when you're generating ideas. What makes you stand out? What makes you different to the B&B down the road? What makes your food better or different to the restaurant down the road? And it's not always about better. It's about different, and it's about how can you showcase what you do in the best light. So we're going to think about, once you've started to think about those ideas and the creative ways that you can showcase your business, we're going to think about what key questions are you going to consider to help you start to plan that video content out. So you've got an idea, you've got what you think you might do, but you need to think about things that are going to make this video successful and also what you're going to do with it once you've created it. So you're going to think about the following questions. We're going to think about, what are people searching for in the market? Because again, it's very tempting for you to go and create a video about something that you're interested in or that you think people are interested in. But what you think people are interested in and what people are actually searching for could be two very different things. So do really think about that. What are people actively searching for? And that's the sort of content that you should be creating. We want to think about the purpose. What is the purpose of this video? Is it to generate leads? Is it to build brand awareness? Is it to get more bookings? Is it to tell people about a new event that you've got? Is it to tell people about a new service that you're offering? Is it just about getting people to share it? Is it about customer engagement? There are loads of different things or reasons why you would be making video content. So it's so important to think about that purpose from the outset, because if this video is about brand awareness, that's going to be a completely different video style to something that's going to be about making a booking, or that's something it's about a new event. So do be aware of what your purpose actually is from the outset before creating your video. You want to think about your audience. Who is your audience? Who do you want to appeal to with this video? And the beauty with video is that you can actually make small changes sometimes to video, like change the music or change the graphics. And that can actually allow you to appeal to a different audience very easily and very quickly. But do think about your audience, because you might showcase certain aspects of your business to a younger audience and other aspects of your business to an older audience. You might have a more adventurous audience that you might want to show certain experiences that they might get involved in. But then you might also have a more chilled out, relaxed style of experiences that will be a completely different audience. So do really, really consider that and how you can showcase that best in the video. Back to the storytelling. What is the story that you want to tell? You want people to be able to connect with you. You want people to feel that emotion and to really, you know, lean on those senses and for you really to be memorable. And that storytelling allows people to, as I say, connect on that emotional level. Are you solving a problem? Are you answering a question? Are there lots of questions being answered out there? Like things to do in Belfast, things to do in Northern Ireland, Belfast tours, tours of Northern Ireland. Are you actually looking at what people are searching for, back to that, and answering a question or solving a problem? And if you are, again, that makes for very, very good content. Do you have a call to action? Again, what do you want people to do once they've watched this video? It's all well and good creating a video, but if people don't know why they're watching it, or you're not telling people what to do at the end of it, it's again almost pointless. So do think about that call to action. Is it sign up to our newsletter? Is it visit our website? Is it why not book now? Is it find out about our new event? Is it subscribe to our YouTube channel? think about what you want people to do and make sure you're sharing that with them at the end of the video, and that you also share the information to enable them to do that. And back to what my key point here is to plan. Really think about all these things and plan them in before you start going off and creating video. Because if you don't have this all in your mind and this all set out, when you go to market your video, it's going to be very, very difficult because you don't have this structure in mind and you're basically not focused on your audience. You're not focused on your purpose, and it can make it marketing the video a little bit more difficult, and you don't maybe get the engagement that you would if you're very, very focused in your planning stage. So without further ado, we're going to move on to looking at top tips for video creation. So once you've done all your planning and your creative side of it, we're now going to look at the nitty-gritty of actually getting down and creating a video. So let's jump into that and look at the different aspects that you might want to be considering. So the first thing we're going to think about is lighting. Now, lighting can really mean the difference between a video that sits here and a video that sits here. It can really change the production value and really make your video a lot more professional if you just consider this before you start. Now, the beauty with tourism is that a lot of the time you will be filming outside, and that is perfect because when we talk about lighting, the first thing we really want to do is to find a position or a place with plenty of natural light. Natural light is your friend. So the beauty with tourism is that a lot of the time we are filming outside, so that makes life a wee bit easier. Now, if you are using natural light, and whether that be from a window or being from outside, make sure that you always face the light. Do not have the light behind you, because what happens then is it puts your face in shadow or puts your subject in shadow. So make sure that you're always facing the light and allowing the light to come onto you or onto what you want to film. But if you are inside and say, for example, you're filming a bedroom or a restaurant or something like that, things like LED lights are a really good option. They're really quite inobtrusive and also quite a really good value option. They're probably, the little one I've got you shown on there in my presentation was probably about £20 to £30. And again, they're great because you can just set them up and light up a room or an area very, very easily and very, very quickly. So do consider lighting. It is really important. So we're going to also think about setting. Now, again, setting is really, really, really important in the industry that we're in, because the amazing settings that we can actually have behind us can make such a difference. And if you've got a beautiful setting that you can use, do go out and use it. Make use of that scenery, make use of everything else that's going around you. But what I would say is that if you're going to do something that's very face to camera or informational and you want people to be able to hear, if you can keep the shot clean. And what I mean by that is, say for example, you were at an event and you wanted to give a lot of information and you were doing a piece to camera, you would want to be making sure that you don't have loads of busyness going around behind you, because what you don't want to do is distract people from what you're saying. But however, if you were at an event and you wanted to really showcase the buzz and the atmosphere and the excitement, then I would keep talking to a minimum and allow the shot to be busy behind you. So it's back to that planning and thinking about what your purpose for the video is, but keeping the shot clean can really make a clip look better and makes it a lot less distracting for the person who's watching it. If you're in, say for example, and you want to do something very informational, you might want to have a very clean or tidy background or a simple white wall if you want to do a very face to camera piece. And again, back to the aesthetics, if you're filming in a bedroom or you're filming in a restaurant, you want it to look as beautiful as possible in the background. Framing is also very important. And what we talk about framing is framing that shot. So for example, if you're going to have someone speaking in the shot, you're going to have to really think about headroom. And we're talking probably about half a centimetre between the top of the frame and the person's head. So what you don't want is an extreme close-up. And you also don't want the person being so far away that they look lost in the shot. So do feel free to make sure that you play around with that. And if you look in your camera settings in most mobile phones, in most modern mobile phones now, you'll be able to actually turn on RID mode. And I will show you a wee screenshot of that as well in here. And that will actually help you position your headroom and think about your framing a little bit better as well. What we also would say is to look at, again, and it depends on the type of mobile phone you're using, but a lot of phones now will have a lock mode or a focus mode. On Apple, it's called Focus AE Lock Mode. And what you do, again, and I will show you in a screenshot, is to just hold your finger onto the person or the subject where you're filming. And what this will do is it will stop the video, the camera or the mobile phone auto-focusing in and out. So what will happen is when you're filming, mobile phone will automatically focus on the subject. But if something moves in the background, it will move focus to that movement. And what you don't want to do is to end up with a blurred subject. So being able to hold that focus allows you to maintain that focus on your mobile phone. We're going to also talk about audio. Now, especially if you're going to do quite a lot of talking or you want to give an informational piece, audio is going to be really, really important. People will forgive production quality, but they will not forgive audio quality. If the production quality isn't amazing, but they can't hear it, people will just turn away and switch off from your video. So do be free to really think about your audio before you start. So if you're talking in your video, of course, it makes common sense to choose somewhere where the noise levels are appropriate for your video. So if, again, if you're in an event and you want to be talking about the event, do move away from the very busyness and the background and the noise. A lav mic for your device might be something that you might want to invest in, because this really does help reduce background noise and have a better quality. So what it will do is it will still pick up background noise, but it will focus in your voice. And I've got some pictures on there of different types of little lav mics. And as you can see, they just pop onto your lapel. Again, really reasonably priced. And you can get ones that actually will plug into mobile phones, into iPads, into tablets, and even into laptops as well. So again, if you want to just take your audio quality up a bit, it's something that you might want to invest in. And what I've also got there is a little fluffy wind muff as well. Also, a little fluffy wind muff might be something that you want to put just over your lav mic. And what it'll do is just reduce that wind sound a little bit. It won't eliminate it entirely, but it will reduce it. So it is something to consider, especially if you're a tour guide or someone that's going to be filming outside a lot. So the next thing we're going to talk about is music. Now, music is so important because music can actually change the feeling and the emotion of a video straight away. It can make the difference between people watching and turning away immediately. So do really think about your music. It is important to note that music you use must be royalty-free to avoid any copyright violations. And there's loads of either royalty-free music out there or subscription models where you can actually buy music or subscribe to music and use those. But do be very careful. You can't just record a song from the radio or a song from a CD and put it over your video. You will get into trouble. So please be aware of that. Choose your music appropriately. Again, back to thinking about the purpose of your video and thinking about the audience. Again, different types of music will resonate with different types of audiences, and that can really, really help with the storytelling element of your video. Have it play at a relevant volume in particular stages. So for example, if you are showing just B-roll, and what we mean by B-roll is scenery or pictures or things that aren't you maybe face to camera, you might want to increase the level of volume. But if you're talking or you want to listen to a sound or an atmosphere, you might want to lower the level of the volume of the music so that people can actually hear what's going on or what people are saying. So do be aware of that. But again, I can't, please don't underestimate the power of music and how it can really lend itself to making a video successful or not. Graphics are another really, really good way of, again, adding to the professionalism of video. So they can be very useful, like adding on-screen information. So here you can see, and this is one of Tours in Northern Ireland's videos, and it's Giant's Causeway, County Antrim, and I think it was something like, you know, 10 places to visit. And again, it can really just give people that wee bit more information, but also take that professionalism up a bit. It's great for, again, adding people's names or a company logo, or really showcasing that brand awareness. And don't underestimate the use of photos as well. Just because you're creating video, it doesn't mean that you can't also use video photos in there. And you can actually put those throughout your video to mix it up and keep it engaging. So say, for example, you're a tour guide and you have some beautiful scenery shots, especially if I'm thinking about weather here in Northern Ireland. So you might be doing a tour guiding video, and the weather might not be beautiful, but you might have some beautiful photos that were taken on a lovely sunny day that you might want to drop in to mix up that video. You can also use those in videos as well. So do make sure that you dig out those videos and mix or photos and mix them in with your videos. So we're also going to think about intros and outros. And what I mean by intros and outros are that sort of introductory screen and that end screen that you see in videos. Again, it's a brilliant way to develop brand consistency and brand awareness, because if you can start to open your videos in the same way every time with a nice logo or a little piece of music, it starts to get people used to your brand and how you present your brand. And it helps you develop that consistency when you're introducing your business, because the people immediately see that little introduction screen and they think, yeah, oh, I know where that video is coming from. I know who these guys are. I know what they do. Their events are amazing. Yes, I'm going to watch the video. And it really, really helps to do that. Your end screen is equally important, because this is where we would really add that call to action. You can add email addresses, phone numbers, links for booking, and really give people that information that they need to go on and do something from your video, to actually take that action, to make that booking, to sign up to that newsletter. And it's a great place to drop all that information in. So again, considering that in your planning phase of where you're going to get those things from. The likes of Canva is a great wee free tool that will help you create these intro and outro screens. And the beauty is, if you create them once, you can just keep on dropping them in your editing, and you don't have to keep creating them every single time. So, you know, do be aware of that as well, because I know we don't have all day to be sitting making videos all day. So I am aware that, you know, we want to try and be as efficient as possible in this process and really reuse and recycle as much as we possibly can. So I want to also talk about just different types of shots that you might take when you're creating video content. So you will want to use a wide variety of shots. You just don't always want to be pointing the camera straight, and that's the only shot that you have, because people will disengage and they'll not you'll not hold their attention. So you might want to use wide shots, which are, as I say, show the whole scene, and we would sometimes call those an establishing shot. And these are great for an opening scene where you want to show the whole thing, everything that's happening there in all its glory. Then we would have a medium shot, and a medium shot is probably what you're seeing from me right now, which is kind of from the waist up. So it's that slightly closer in, but not too close. And then you've got obviously a close-up shot. And this is great if you're honing in on the likes of food or drinks or very small details that you really want to showcase. Over the shoulder can be a nice different perspective. And again, that really helps people empathize and put themselves in your shoes or in the visitor's shoes, because they're seeing it from a different perspective. So again, play around with that and see what works for your business. And different heights and perspectives are also a really, really good way of, again, mixing it up. I saw a really creative video there recently with different heights and perspectives, and it was actually a wedding, and it was a venue promoting their wedding services. And basically they had a lovely shot of basically the phone or the camera on the floor and all the different shoes coming in at the wedding. So all the different ladies' shoes. And it was just a really creative, lovely perspective, something a wee bit different that really set the scene at the beginning of the video with all the glamour and the beauty and the lovely shoes all coming in. And it really set the scene for their wedding showcase video. So do think about how a different height and different perspective can really make a difference. And obviously that comes into drone shots and things as well. So that can really, really, again, take a video up a level and really add to that engagement and make people want to watch more. You might also want to think about putting a bit of movement in as well. When you get a little bit more experienced with video, we tend to go very static at the beginning and we just take shots and shots and shots and shots, and that's fine. Those still shots are absolutely perfect. I would say if you are taking still shots though, if you can hold them for about 5 seconds, that's going to be really, really useful when you come to the editing process. If you say, for example, have your mobile phone in front of you and you're moving very quickly, it's very, very hard to cut those shots. But if you've got nice 5 seconds, you can cut 2 or 3 seconds out and then cut another 2 or 3 seconds out. So do be aware of that. So camera movements, again, it's nice to put a bit of movement in there to keep people engaged and to allow people who are viewing your video to enjoy it. And you're thinking the likes of a pan shot. So you would have your mobile phone and you're just panning very, very slowly from side to side. And that gives a nice wide shot or a wide impression of everything that's going on. You might have a tilt up and down, so you'll have your mobile phone and you'll tilt it up and then you will tilt it back down, and again that gives a lovely movement and gives different perspectives of, say, a room or people in a room or an event that's happening. And then you can also have a slide shot, which is slightly different to the pan because it's kind of more back and forward, so you have your phone and it'll literally just be sliding back and forth. And these are really, really nice for transition shots, especially if you're filming, like, for example, in a property, a hotel or a B&B, sliding from one room to another can work really, really effectively. So do think about those different movements. And the thing I want to really say about this all is this is all trial and error. You're not going to make your first video and go, look, this is Hollywood production, I'm so happy with it. It will be different. You will try different things and things will work better and things will, you'll think, no, I'm never going to do that again. And it is, a trial and error thing for your different business and for your service. And it does come with practice. So, do stick at it and think about what works well and take the positives and move forward with those. So I just wanted to talk about camera settings as well, because that's going to be very important. So if you look in your phone settings, you will see that you'll have an option of 1080p or 4K. Now, ideally, you would be filming in 4K. That's the highest quality that you can film in, and it will really future-proof your video content. But I understand as well that it does take up a lot of space. So if you don't have a lot of storage on your phone, 1080p will be fine. But if you can try to film in 1080p at the least and not go below that, because you will start to get grainy pixelated footage, especially as the light gets darker. So 1080p is perfect, but 4K even better. I would also put my grid settings on, as we talked previously about setting and framing. It's really important that you're able to position your subject or the person that you're filming in the right place, and the grid will help you to do that. So check out this little video that I'm just going to play to show you how to do those settings. What I would also say, a point to note, is that unless you're filming specifically for Instagram, I would always film in landscape. And the reason for this is because it means if you want to edit later on, you want to crop in, and you want to take parts out of the video or move it in a bit closer, you've plenty of scope to do that. If you film in horizontal or vertical, it makes it very, very difficult because you've not got much space to work with. Landscape will also give you a nicer, wider shot, and you can get obviously more detail into your shot. So always landscape, and you can always crop it later. The beauty is as well, is that if you film landscape, you can actually convert it as well for Instagram. So it's not as if you can't use it for Instagram. So always landscape, unless you're not going to use it anywhere else but Instagram. So I would also want to talk about just preparation. And these are a nice few points to get you thinking about before you actually start filming. So the first thing I would want to say is plan what you want to say. So if you're going to speak on camera, do plan what you want to say. Think about maybe 3 to 5 key points. You don't want to be going off on a tangent or talking for 20 minutes when you can actually say the same thing in 3 minutes. So do plan what you want to say and just maybe list it on some little bullet points. If you're going to be using your mobile phone, I would say enable flight mode. There's nothing more annoying than being in the middle in full flow and your video's perfect and your setting's perfect and your lighting's perfect and you've got what you want to say and somebody starts to ring you in the middle or you get a text message and that distracts you. So if you enable flight mode, it means then that you won't be distracted throughout your video. I would also say as well, position the phone slightly below eye level and look at the camera lens, because especially if it's going to be a very face to camera video, you want to be engaging with your audience. You want to feel, they want to feel like you're speaking to them. And if your eye contact, if I was speaking to you like this and I was looking around everywhere, it makes it quite hard to watch because you kind of think, what is that person looking at? And you start to get really nosy and you lose focus on what the video is actually saying to you. So do try to maintain the focus with the camera lens. And I know it's really difficult, but it does come with practice and you will get better at it. What I would also say as well is stabilize the camera or the mobile phone, because again, there's nothing more unprofessional than a camera or a shot that's jiggling around everywhere. So do make sure that you stabilize it. And I will talk about this in a minute with some tools that you might use for filming. And what I would do as well is really, really important is to pause for a few minutes before and at the end. And this will help with editing. And I'm going to do something really weird here now. And I hope this isn't going to be the highlight of this video. So what I would say is at the beginning, just pause and get yourself ready for what you want to say. And it will be really weird. The ending will be even weirder, so don't worry. It'll be really weird. But what it means is when you want to edit, you're not going to be mid-flow talking. So what I would say is if I want to just talk about this point, I will pause first, compose myself. Hello, and welcome to the video. And that just gives you that opportunity to pause and cut when you're editing. And the same at the end, and this is the weird part, because what you probably want to do at the end is just to stop and smile, and it'll feel really, really fake. So I will say, and that's all from us today. Thank you so much for watching. And then cut. It's the weirdest thing and it looks really weird, but actually what we'll do is it'll actually give you an opportunity to be able to cut. If I just stop talking immediately and move away, I can't cut that and it makes it very difficult in the editing process. So do think about that. What I also want to talk about is tools for filming. So tools for filming that you might want to use. If you don't have any tools whatsoever, you've only got yourself and you've got your mobile phone, what I would say the key thing to stabilize it is to use both hands to hold the mobile phone, to lock your elbows into your body for extra stability, and that will really help steady up any shot. So if you're out and about and you're doing some scenery, just hold it in the two hands and lock your elbows in. Or if you've got physical supports around you, like shelves, tables, chairs, you can rest your phone on there. And again, that will help keep your shot stabilized. There are also things like tripods, stabilizers, and camera cages. And they're also other useful equipment that you can use. And I will show you little screenshots of those in use as well. So you want to probably, a tripod is very good. It's very, very static. But if you want to be moving around a lot, I would suggest in maybe investing in a stabilizer. And basically what they are is you pop your mobile phone on there and it will actually stabilize it and make it really seamless. And these are beautiful sorts of shots for if you're filming any sort of indoors or property side shot where you want to add a bit of movement, but you want it to be steady. Or equally, they're excellent for the likes of tour guides who are out and constantly on the move and are moving and they want to have their shots not jumping around everywhere as they're going up and down hills and mountains. That can really help stabilize it. And a little camera cage can also be something that's very useful. It will allow you to attach lights and mics on there as well and gives you that stability. So do think about those different styles of equipment that's going to help you. So we're going to think now about video editing tips. So I'm not going to talk really about a specific editing software because there are so many really good ones out there, and it will depend on the device you're using. So it might be that you're using an Apple phone or an Android phone, and the different apps that you can use will vary in terms of the different tools that they'll have within them and what's best for the different operating systems. So what I am going to talk about is the tools that you might use and where you might use them and how you might use them to really edit that video together. What I would say is that editing, people are afraid of it because they think it's a really, really hard process and it's a really long process, and it really doesn't have to be. The apps that are out there at the minute are amazing. You can edit a video very quickly on a phone in probably 10 to 15 minutes. And I would actually say a small amount of editing goes a long way in making your video quite professional. And if you do make the effort to go and create, as I say, those little intro or outro screens beforehand and have those prepared, even just dropping them on can really help. The planning will also really help as well, because if you have your video well planned and thinking, taking into account all of those different things that we talked about in the planning, and you know the shots that you want, if you're not out just getting random shots, the editing process is going to be very, very quick. If you've got your 10 shots that you need and you film those in sync, you will have a lot less editing to do. So do consider those sorts of things before you go into your filming process. So let's look at some of the different terminology or tools that you might be facing when you go into video editing. So the first thing we're going to think about is trimming a clip. Now, trimming a clip is basically cutting a piece off a clip. And when we use the trim tool, this will traditionally be trimming a bit off the beginning or the end of a clip. So, for example, what I've just said about you holding the smile or that beginning part where people are getting prepared before they talk, you can trim that off really, really easily. And by using just a drag, you just drag that bit off. And that allows you to trim the clip. The next tool that you might be faced with is splitting a clip. Now, this helps you for two reasons. The first reason that we're going to think about is that it allows you to split clips up into different sections. So for example, you might want to, if you see on my screen here, you might want to have the first part of the clip, you might want to have music on that. The second part of the clip, you might want to have graphics on that. And by splitting it up, it allows you to manipulate those clips into their own sections. If you want to trim a bit of a clip that's in the middle, like for example, if you're talking and you've made a mistake in the middle, if you just split the clip where that mistake is, you can then trim that off there as well. So that's really the two main reasons that you would be using to split a clip. A, to manipulate a section, or B, to trim something from between the middle of a clip. Adding text. And adding text can really, really, really take a video up a level in terms of professionalism. And back to what we said about adding names, adding information, adding email details, adding just locations can be really, really powerful. So as you can see on this screen, I've just added a nice intro screen which says Derry Halloween, and again you can see immediately how the introduction to my clip, now I know exactly what I'm getting when I'm watching this, and it just takes everything up a little level in terms of as I say, that professionalism and that consistency, and it makes people feel like there's been a bit of effort put into the video and they know what they're getting when they watch it. So I also want to talk about the PIP tool, and it's a really great wee tool. It actually means photo in picture. And what it means is you can actually drop a photo and sometimes even a video in some of these apps into the scene that you're in. So if you can imagine, you could be talking and then you can have photos popping up beside you and actually coming up as you're talking about the different parts of the tour. For example, you might say we start off at the Giant's Causeway and then we go to the next place. And those little images can be popping up as you talk through. So again, a really, really nice way of showcasing different parts of the tour and keeping people engaged so that it's not always just maybe face to camera. This is a great way of dropping other elements in and mixing it up a little bit. Filters and effects. I would say use filters and effects with caution. They're a really, really good way of jazzing up videos, but they can really change the mood of a video very quickly. And they can also really take the production level of a video down very quickly if they're not used appropriately. So I would say do use those with caution. You will also, in most of these apps, have an opportunity to adjust. And what that will mean is it means that you can actually adjust the video after it's been produced or filmed. So you can usually adjust the brightness, the contrast, saturation, temperature or sharpness. Now you will be able to, as I say, adjust them slightly. But again, I would try to, if you can, get the video right when during filming and make the small adjustments afterwards. Because what you don't want to do is film in a really dark area and say, oh, it's okay, I can just adjust it in editing. It's very difficult actually to brighten something up to a really good level if it's a really dark situation. So do think about this as a tool to make minor tweaks and changes rather than completely fix or transform a video. Again, back to the music, and adding music is again something that can really, really have an effect on your video. I would say do be aware of the copyright, and a lot of these apps will actually have music attached to them. YouTube does also have copyright free music, so do have a wee look at their library and the library within some of these apps, but just do be aware that if you're going to be using music, that you have the license or the copyright to do so. And again, these tools are very, very easy to do. We just basically drop the music on and drag and drop where we want it to appear in the clip, and you can adjust the volume as you go. A voiceover is another really, really nice way of, again, back to what I said at the beginning, of creating a nice scenery video or an informational piece. And most of the apps in the mobile phones, in the editing apps, they will allow you to record a voiceover directly within the app, which is absolutely amazing. So what you can do is actually just have your clip and then talk over it. So you don't have to worry about timing or practicing. You can actually have your script written and just read it and record it over. So do be aware that that's a really, really good little tool that you can use to add information to a piece of video later on afterwards. You don't always need to feel the pressure of doing it at that exact time. And then transitions. These can be added to, again, help transition between different clips. So if you've got three or four different clips, you will add maybe a little transition, and that could be a swipe, it could be black to white, it could be a small fade, it could be a swipe. There's loads of different ways, and you would play around with those to look at what suits the style of your video. But what it just means is that when people are watching the video and you move from one scene to the other, that it's not a big sharp transition, and it would jar with you when you're watching it. This will actually just help the video flow. And a lot of these apps will automatically add transitions in, and you can go in and change them. But again, it depends on the app that you're actually using. And then I'm going to go back to the call to action, because it's so important, and I really want to mention it in the editing process, because again, back to what do you want people to do after you've went out, you've planned this video, you've created it, you've edited it, it looks beautiful. What are you going to get people to do? Are they signing up to the newsletter? Are they booking a tour? Are they booking a trip, visiting your website, leaving a review? What do you want them to do? What do you want them to actually physically go and do after they've watched this video? Because this is the key point. This is why we're making the videos. So do please really think about that and add that into your editing process. So I'm going to move on to questions now and allow people to ask questions, because I know I've given you a lot of information. And do, as I say, feel free to revisit this and watch it over again. I hope it's been useful. I would also want to draw your attention to the upcoming TED Digital Workshop. So we've got video marketing on Thursday. So do, now you're going to create all your videos? Do you follow up on that? What are you going to do with them and how you're going to market them? We're going to also look at YouTube, how you optimize YouTube for SEO and setting up that YouTube channel, SEO and social media on the 26th of June. So again, how you can actually start to use this content and put it into your SEO and social media strategy. And then photography, which obviously goes hand in hand with the videography. So do make sure that you sign up to those, and they're all on the Eventbrite and all on Tourism Northern Ireland's website. So without further ado, thank you so much for tuning in. I hope you found it useful. Do feel free to ask questions. I will be around for the next 20 minutes or so. And I look forward to seeing all those videos. Do feel free to share them with me as well, and we'll share them out on our social media. So really hope you enjoyed it, and we will see you all again soon.